morning.
Good morning.
My name is Fritz. If I haven't met you, I would love to. If you want to know more about our church, I'm happy to talk with you about Redeemer. As a pastor, sometimes it's hard because you're worried about the service to know, to just hear from the Lord, because you're so worried about sort of doing your job. And I just want to say again, thank you to all of those in this church that serve in various ways, Sunday school, anyways, but thank you for the music. I don't know if y'all meant for that to tie right into our passage this morning, but it did. Sometimes God's sovereignty hurts. Sometimes it just is so glorious that you're just like, that's awesome. That song that they were referring to is probably the most known song in the universe, Psalm 23. But if you think about the heart of what that psalm is saying for a minute, is God really with you, spreading a feast in the presence of your enemies? I've talked to some of you already this morning, just in passing, and you have told me about very difficult, sticky situations, either at work, people confronting death, marriages breaking apart, and all sorts of things that we're involved with in a daily basis. And sometimes it's very hard for us to look at those situations and see that in the midst of our enemies, God is actually preparing a feast, a table. And so that's what we're going to be looking at this morning. Look at 1 Kings chapter 18. If you are new to your Bible, 1 Kings is about a fourth of the way through. It's in the Old Testament. It comes after 1 and 2 Samuel. 1 Kings, we are looking at two prophets that God raised up in a particular season of the life of His people, Elijah and Elisha. So I'm going to read chapter 18, verses 1 through 19. Hear the word of God. After many days, the word of the Lord came to Elijah in the third year, saying, "Go, show yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain upon the earth." So Elijah went to show himself to Ahab. Now the famine was severe in Samaria, and Ahab called Obadiah, who was over the household. Now Obadiah feared the Lord greatly. And when Jezebel cut off the prophets of the Lord, Obadiah took 100 prophets and hid them by 50s in a cave and fed them with bread and water. And Ahab said to Obadiah, "Go through the land to all the springs of water and to all the valleys. Perhaps we may find grass and save the horses and mules alive and not lose some of the animals." So they divided the land between them to pass through it. Ahab went in one direction by himself, and Obadiah went in another direction by himself. And as Obadiah was on the way, behold, Elijah met him. And Obadiah recognized him and fell on his face and said, "Is it you, my lord Elijah?" And he answered him, "It is I. Go, tell your lord, behold, Elijah is here." And he said, "How have I sinned that you would give your servant into the hand of Ahab to kill me? As the Lord your God lives, there is no nation or kingdom where my Lord has not sent to seek you." And when they would say, "He is not here," he would take an oath of the kingdom or nation that they had not found you. And now you say, "He is not," I'm sorry, "and now you say, 'Go, tell your Lord, behold, Elijah is here.' And as soon as I have gone from you," again, we saw this last week with the rugged honesty of the Bible. One of the reasons that you should believe the Bible is God's word is right here. Listen to God's servant pushing back with Elijah. "As soon as I have gone from you, the Spirit of the Lord will carry you I know not where. And so when I come and tell Ahab and he cannot find you, he will kill me, although I, your servant, have feared the Lord from my youth. Has it not been told my Lord what I did when Jezebel killed the prophets of the Lord, how I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50s in a cave and fed them with bread and water? And now you say, go tell your Lord, behold, Elijah is here, and he will kill me. And Elijah said, as the Lord of hosts lives, behold, before whom I stand, I will surely show myself to him today. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When Ahab saw Elijah, Ahab said to him, is it you, you troubler of Israel? And he answered, I have not troubled Israel, but you have, and your father's house, because you have abandoned the commandments of the Lord and followed the Baals. Now therefore send and gather all Israel to me at Mount Carmel, and the 450 prophets of Baal, and the 400 prophets of Asherah, who eat at Jezebel's table. Let's pray. God, thank you for the rugged honesty of your word. Thank you for how real it is. Thank you how it testifies to your glory and goodness and your truthfulness. Thank you for how honest it is about the wrestling that we incur. Would you, through your Holy Spirit, give us both understanding and hearts that see more and more of your glory and beauty, even as we look into your word. And you, Lord, through that, that you would equip those who are your people and draw and reach those who are not yet your people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I mentioned some of the sticky situations that I have heard about already this morning. I was in a sticky situation yesterday. Took my son skiing, not to Colorado, but to Perfect North outside of Cincinnati. It's not the sticky situation of me on a pair of skis. That's sticky enough. But it was the sticky situation that we brought his friend, and within 20 minutes it was clear and obvious after spending roughly $70 a person that his friend was not going to ski anymore. He didn't even make it through a third of ski school. And so there I was in this sticky situation. What do I do? This kid is 12. Do I let him sit by himself for 5 hours? Do I call his parents? Hope they drive up to Cincinnati. Do we call it a day and go home? Do I go ski with my son? That is a sticky situation with such minor consequences in light of some of the uncomfortable, awkward, hard, even dangerous, challenging situations that we find ourselves in. Maybe for you it is a relationship sticky situation. You don't know how to handle it. Maybe it is something you are going through personally, or someone that you are involved in their life. Maybe it's something happening at work. Maybe it is someone complaining about your hospital or your job performance. Maybe it is your marriage. It is a sticky situation. Maybe it is your grandchildren that you don't know how to navigate it. We, in a couple weeks, Lord willing, you will vote through the direction of God's Spirit to elect more officers to this church. And if you are being nominated and elected to the officer of elder or deacon, you will find yourself in very sticky situations where very often you step back and you realize, how do we navigate this? How do we handle this? If you remember, the larger context of this passage that we read is this passage was actually written for God's people when they were in exile in Babylon. In other words, they're living in a foreign country under foreign power, asking, how do we live faithfully before God as exiles? You may remember referring to a passage where God said, plant trees, marry, build houses. But even if you have that instruction from God, it still puts you in sticky situations, doesn't it? Okay, we build houses, we keep having children, we keep trying to be a blessing to the city, but that doesn't tell you what to do in every single sticky, awkward, hard situation, does it? The micro context of this passage is that it's written about God's people during a time of theological and spiritual exile. In other words, as we saw in the past chapter, it is dark and evil. God's king has rejected him, the true God, and is leading his people to worship false images. The foundations are not just being destroyed in the world, but in the church. In other words, Yahweh's glory is not trending. Animals are more valued than people. Let's save the animals. We don't care about people dying. The words of other religions are valued more highly than God's words. Prophets are being hunted down and destroyed. You thought church might be hard for you today? I promise it's a lot less challenging than this situation. As a matter of fact, Elijah, the major prophet of this passage, is the subject of a manhunt. There is a drought of the word, and there is a drought of rain. God's people are actually hostile to God's people. It is sticky to say the least. So how do we live, whether that is your situation, even in the church or in the world? These four views, I'm going to just say these very concisely, but I want to put them out there. If you want to see these later, I'm happy to show you or email you. But these are four views with regard to how you navigate sticky situations. These are floating out there. I'm not even sure where they came from. The last person I heard to use them was a pastor named Joe Novenson at Lookout Mountain Presbyterian Church. So here are the four views of how we engage and navigate a sticky world or sticky situations. Number one, passive assimilation. Passive assimilation. In other words, there's nothing we can do. We want to be seen as relevant. Forget what faithfulness looks like. We're just going to move along with the world and the current and all the idols that are floating out there. And we're going to behave like the world. Passive assimilation. Secondly, belligerent opposition. In other words, not behave like, but be against. In other words, one of the fruit of the Spirit is to always oppose everything. The sign you're a Christian means that you're against everything, and you end up finding yourself a very angry person, boiling over and militant. The third, avoidant isolation. In other words, I want to be faithful, I'm not sure how to be faithful, but I'm going to keep the values of the Word of God, but in isolation from the world. We talked about this the past couple weeks. In other words, live in a bubble. Ghetto Christianity. Avoid the world. The fourth is this, and this is what we're going to see in this passage. Gospel engagement. In other words, that God's kingdom is above all kingdoms. Right? This kingdom is pursuing Elijah. I'm already jumping into the heart of the passage. Sorry, forgive me. But God's kingdom is at work. God's kingdom is at work in the midst of every other kingdom. And God's people are actually called to participate that and infiltrate the world. And to infiltrate sticky situations. So, how are we going to look at this morning? Two ways. Number one, how do we engage the world? And secondly, how does God engage the world, more importantly? So first of all, how do we engage the world? God is saying it's gospel engagement, kingdom in the midst of every other kingdom. Let's look at that for a minute. The first thing that we see under this of how to engage the world is that you see through the example of Elijah and Obadiah, faithfulness to God and faithfulness to His Word. Now, we as Christians do not believe that the Bible is a book of examples that you are just supposed to follow in every situation and be like this person. If you go down that road, you're going to see a lot of crazy things that God's people do. But in this case, in this scenario, you see two of God's servants being faithful to Him. You see Elijah, look again at verse 1. After many days, the word of the Lord came to Elijah and said, "Go show yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain, and tell him I will send rain upon the earth." So Elijah went. Elijah's name actually means either servant of the Lord or Yahweh is Lord. In other words, Elijah is being faithful to God's word. God says, "Go before that king that wants to kill you," and he goes. We see it in Obadiah. Obadiah means servant of the Lord. But in Obadiah's case, you see through verses 8 through 16 that even though he does eventually obey God and he's faithful to God, what happens first? He wrestles with the Word of God, doesn't he? We'll talk about that in a minute. But the point is this. They are both faithful to God and to His Word. Both servants are faithful to God's Word and engaged in a messy, unfaithful world. And in this case, the world is in the church. Does that make sense? The spirit of the age is in the church, and they're not running from it. They're engaged in it, being faithful to God and to His Word. But, you probably noticed this, it's flexible faithfulness. What I mean by that is not that they could sort of do whatever they wanted to do. I'm going to follow God and I'm just going to figure that out. And this is not relativism. What I mean by that is simply how they go about serving God is grounded in His Word, and yet it looks very different, doesn't it? It's what some people have called fixed theology and flexible methodology. In other words, if you look at Elijah, notice the differences between him and Obadiah. Elijah is an office bearer of God. He is a prophet of God. His role is more declarative, isn't it? Right? He's outside the court of Ahab. He sort of comes and goes. And yet he's very direct. He's very bold. Even intrusive. And just by note, if you have this gift, so to speak, word of caution. This, you don't just reach for that tool all the time, right? But in other words, Elijah is more like a tank. He just comes in, "Ahab, you're in trouble." Right? But look at Obadiah. Obadiah is an insider. He is the mayor of the palace. He is the head domestic administrator for an evil king. He is over his estates, his livestock, and he even helps him on a daily basis. He is a very high official, and in the midst of his calling and his vocation, what does he do? He hides prophets in caves and feeds them. What I'm suggesting is this from God's Word, that both of these men are faithful to God and faithful to His Word, but it looks very different. And so you have one that's more like a tank and one that is more like special ops, stealth, so to speak. And I suggest this, that our situations, your sticky situations, are more like Obadiah. It doesn't mean that we don't take stands and say hard things and all of that, but it's much more daily, behind-the-scenes faithfulness, where you are a servant of God serving in Ahab's court. We're servants of God serving amidst ungodly regimes. You can imagine the sticky situation that Obadiah got up every morning and probably pray to the Lord, "God, I don't know how to navigate working for this evil king that is trying to kill your people. And he's throwing up images all over the place. But give me your grace to serve you and navigate this very post-Christian situation. How do I, O Lord, be loyal to you and loyal to my boss? You feel that? You see that? The point is this. God wants us right there. In other words, if you're in a sticky, awkward, difficult, even dangerous, possibly, situation, if you feel persecuted, if you feel the name of Jesus slandered, God wants you in the midst of that. He has you as sort of a covert operation, right? Isn't that sort of a picture of the kingdom? The picture of the church. We come together on Sundays, we kind of recuperate, we rest, we get our marching orders, we realize, we get realigned, that the whole point is God's kingdom and God's name, and we go out for the week, right? And we serve God and stealth operations all over. Think about this for a second. You may not have noticed this in the first reading. Why does Elijah involve Obadiah anyway? Right? He comes along and says, Obadiah, go to the king and tell him. He doesn't have to do that. He could have just went to Elijah, right? But for some reason, he wants to involve Obadiah. And for some reason, in other words, God can work without us. But instead, he normally works through us. He works through the church, bringing about God's kingdom in this world. That doesn't say that the situations are not messy. But what it says is that just like God wanted Elijah in this sticky situation, going before this king who is trying to destroy him, and just like Obadiah had to get up every day and face the question of how am I going to live faithfully to God with an unfaithful boss, God wants us there. When I did college ministry, I had a freshman my first year named Luke. And Luke sat through the first week of campus. And if you've done this sort of thing at a college campus, you know what this is like. They sort of pound all this information into you, and a lot of it is basically far from what God's Word would say. They give you things for emergency situations. Let's just say it like that. They do all sorts of things. They're sort of pumping their message into you. And after that week, I saw Luke, and Luke said, I just want to destroy them all. This is all bad. This is all evil. He just wanted to take a tank and just, I'm like, really? No, he didn't take a tank. I said, Luke, I understand. What they're doing is sort of evil, isn't it? Do you have any evil in you? That began a process of conversations that enabled Luke to begin actually not hating those people, but loving them. Not always having the answers to navigate every situation. Over time, Luke was so gifted at photography, he got 3 different appointments by the New York Times to work under the Bush administration and the Obama situation. Flew on Air Force One. His work is all over. He was in many, many sticky situations. Ephesians 2 says this, that God brings glory to himself by equipping the church, not necessarily for great, flashy works, but for what? Good works. Daily works, wrestling with God's Word, wrestling with how to apply it, wrestling with wisdom. You know what the difference with wisdom is this? The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom is not always knowing the right thing to do, but being so saturated and immersed in God's Word and God's people that we become the type of person that simply does the right thing, that navigates and has skill at life. How does this come about, though? It's interesting if you look in both cases, Elijah and Obadiah. How was it that they had the courage and the guts, not just the being compelled, but how is it that they had the courage and the guts to go before this king and be immersed in that sticky situation? You see it in both of them, verse 13 and verse 15. Look at verse 13. Has it not been told my Lord what I did when Jezebel killed the prophets of the Lord, how I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50s in a cave and fed them with bread and water? He's been bold, he's been courageous, and yet he's wrestling with God's word. And then verse 14, behold, if I go tell the king, behold, Elijah's here, what's going to happen? He's going to kill me. And Elijah said, as surely as the Lord of hosts lives, before whom I stand, I will surely show myself to him today. Verse 12 says that Obadiah was a man who feared the Lord. And yet, in the midst of fearing the Lord, he's wrestling with fearing for his what? Life. Do you feel that sticky situation? What is it that is going to give him the courage to go into that sticky situation and not be militant against it and not to hide from it or become just like it, but to engage it is a greater fear. You see it in Obadiah. He fears the Lord. He wrestles with his word. In the end, he goes before the king. And you see it in Elijah, who stands before the living God. In other words, the reason that he has the courage to go before a king that has the power to kill him, who he should fear, is because there is someone greater to fear. In other words, both of them have a healthy, living relationship with the true and living God that has so captured their hearts and capture their loves, that His love is supreme over anything else. Let me say it this way. What is going to empower us to go into sticky situations that tend to make us afraid is that there is something we are more fearful of. Right? Let's just put this in silly language. If I am going into, I have a choice of two rooms, and there's a scary spider in this room. You know, I'm scared of spiders. I don't want to go in that room, right? But what if there's a bear in that room? Where am I going to go? That room. I'm afraid of a bear. I just got to nod. Yes. And I'm on the right track. We talk in this church about good fear and bad fear. Bad fears plague our life. We're afraid of what people think. We're afraid of what others are going to say about us. But good fear comes from the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What gives you wisdom to navigate and to engage those sticky situations is a healthy, good fear of one who is more worthy and more valuable than anything else that you find valuable. Let me say it this way. Why was it that Judas sold his Lord down the river? What does the Bible say? Money, yes. You know what was more important to Judas than money? He saw his Lord's kingdom waning. He saw the end. He knew what was going to happen to Jesus. And whom did he fear the most? Chief priests and the people that gave him money. Do you see that? In other words, he wanted to please them. He wanted their approval. They were the power mongers of his day. And that's who he bent toward. Because he feared them in a bad fear way. Their response and what they thought of Judas was most valuable. The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A healthy love of God, that His worth is far more worthy than those things. His glory is more valuable. Okay, Fritz, that's great. But look, how do you get that? How do you know that God is more valuable and more worthy? How do you know you look at God's engagement with the world? In other words, we looked at our engagement with the world, but look at God's engagement with the world here. You can easily overlook it. Let me start this point by saying this. How could God respond to a broken, fallen world? Does God isolate Himself from it? Does God militantly go against it? Fight with this question. This is an important question. Or does God engage it? Think about it this way. If LeBron James comes into the gym, he clearly could say, "Hey, y'all, I'm LeBron James, and I'm going to take anybody one-on-one to prove that." Now, if you're goofy enough to say, "I don't think that's LeBron James," you can say he's not that valuable and that important. And LeBron James would have every right to extend his power over you and go, "I'm LeBron," and just smash you. And let me say, God can do that. And we are going to see a hint of that next week when God pulls back His mercy and says, "I'm going to show you what your idols will get you. False gods are false gods. They're not LeBron in basketball terms. And if you think they are, your whole world is going to be disordered." God could do that. He could say, "All right, I'm going to take you one-on-one." And He's sort of going to do that next week. It's going to be fun. But here, look, what He does first is amazing. Though God is first and to be glorified, and He has the power to make things right and to show Himself in the power way, in other words, to wield that sword, that's not what He does in this passage. What does He tell Elijah to tell Ahab? "Though you haven't turned from your idolatry, though you still make false images, though I've warned you, I've taken rain away, the people around you are dying and your sin is affecting them, and I have every right to come in here and wield a sword," what's He bringing? Rain. Think about this for a second. This is why a lot of people who ascribe to Muslim religion don't like Christians, because of this very point. That God is bringing mercy to His enemies. A wicked idolater who's leading God's people astray, and God is bringing rain. Why? Why is He going to have this big God contest in the rest of chapter 18? Look again at verse 37. I alluded to this a couple weeks ago. What is God up to in all of this drama that we're going to see next week as well? Verse 37. "Answer me, O Lord, answer me. Why? So that this people may know that You, O Lord, are God." They're not acting like it. They're not living according to it. "But so that they may know that You are God, and that You have turned their hearts back." Do you see what He's saying? God is reaching into this evil situation led by an evil regime and saying, "Ahab, I'm going to show you mercy again so that your heart would be turned back to me." In fact, it's worse than that. It's almost as if God isn't faithful to His word. If you look more deeply at verses 17 through 19, what does Ahab call Elijah? "Troubler. You troubler of Israel. And Elijah's like, no, I'm bringing out the tank here.
You're the trouble.
That word is also used in Joshua 6 and 7 for another troubler of Israel, a guy named Achan. And when God sent his peoples as an arm of his very specific judgment into Canaanite land where we are now, he said, don't touch the spoil. If you do, it will damage God's people. And that's exactly what happened. He touched the spoil. It began to have bad consequences for God's people. And he's called a same Hebrew word, a troubler. Does anybody know what happened to Achan? He was punished for disobeying God. God has every right to say to King Ahab, you have not only blasted my glory and tried to defame my name by promoting images, but you're bringing trouble to my people. And he could have swallowed them up in the heart of the earth. Matter of fact, Ahab will get his due eventually. But I would even add that God goes 1,000 extra miles, far more than any of us would, so that hearts would be reached with his love. In other words, God has this habit in the Bible of treating troublers with blessing. God has this habit in the Bible of saying to people who go, you know what? I realize that my sin doesn't just affect myself. I bring trouble on others, including the church, including the world. I'm a troubler. And God's word says this. If you admit that you are a troubler, you're either Ahab or you're Elijah. You're either fighting it and saying, I'm not a troubler, I'm not like them. As long as you have the world or people in the church to point your finger at and say, they're the trouble. Let me give you an example of this. A very local example. I was talking to an African-American man in the gym. He's from the inner city of Louisville. He worked in the suburbs of Louisville. And he worked for the school. He said, man, this wasn't like anything I came from. A guy found an iPhone and he turned it in. You laugh at that, okay? He's like, I didn't know what to do with that. He didn't keep it. He didn't steal it. He turned it in. He said, I took these kids downtown one time, and we were on the bus, and we got to 4th Street, mind you. And you know what all the kids from the suburbs did? They started sinking in their seat. And he said, why are you sinking in your seat? He said, because our parents told us don't make eye contact with anybody and don't look at anybody. You might get hurt. I didn't make that up. In other words, kids, we've got some troubles. They've really got the trouble. It's the same thing that happens in Mark chapter 5. Jesus gets out of the boat with the disciples. There's a demoniac that no one can cure. This dude is so relegated. He's exiled from the community. And as long as that guy is the trouble, people are fine. Until what happens? Jesus saves him. Your trouble can't stand between you and me. Jesus saves him, heals him, casts these demons out. He restores him, so much so that he puts clothes on again. And he comes back to town, and how do the people respond? Jesus, you saved him, you healed him, that's great. We are so thankful. Try to kill him. Why? Because they can't point to the troublers anymore. And it brought up troubles in their own hearts. You think those troubles weren't hurting their community? They're just sort of subdued trouble. God is glorified through faith, through our faithfulness to His Word. But God is also glorified in by being faithful to forgive our unfaithfulness. The God that you can worship and love and fear is not the God like every other God that takes your guilt and takes your shame and takes your trouble and just beats you up with it like that bus illustration does, right? You're like, that's me. You know what this God does? When you admit, that's me, He takes that. He takes all that trouble and does what with it? He puts it on His Son. That's a God you can trust and worship and adore. I'm sure there's a great analogy. I could go with the LeBron James thing, how LeBron James would do that in court. I don't figure it out. But look, He blesses troublers by taking the chief justice, so to speak. Jesus is the chief justice. You realize that? We lost the chief justice this week. Jesus is the chief justice. He's going to judge the world. And He takes the trouble of God's people upon Him. But He didn't just do that. That's grace. That's the gospel. But then what does He do? He says, Obadiah, everybody wants to be a part of a cause today, right? 5Ks, this and that. It's great. He says, Obadiah, I want you to participate in this kingdom. I want you in those sticky situations, leaning on the fear of the Lord that is the beginning of wisdom to navigate all those sticky situations where you're not just engaged in troubling situations with troubling people, but you see your own trouble in the midst of that, and you got to navigate it because God has navigated it for us. And for some reason that I will ask the Lord one day, why in the world did you give the keys of the kingdom to the church? You've heard my silly story. It's the same thing. It's like giving your keys to a teenager. Say, go drive the Ferrari. What? That's what He does. He's navigating His kingdom through us in this world. And if you leave with anything today, know that that is where God wants you. As challenging and as difficult as it is, last quick application to this. One thing that will help you navigate those situations, we talk about this at Redeemer, is community, fellowship of other believers. Elijah doesn't navigate it alone. Obadiah doesn't navigate it alone. We call it one anothering, one another. Navigating together as God extends His kingdom. Let me pray. God, there are difficult things about Your Word. There are glorious things about it. And it is all for Your name's sake. May You be hallowed by the preaching and proclamation of Your Word today. May Your kingdom come and may Your will be done on this earth through this church and other churches in this community. Extending Your kingdom so that our lives, Lord, go into the troubling situations with our own troubles. And Lord, navigate those things so that these lives that we're a part of would look a little bit more like things are done in heaven. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.